afternoon, everyone. So happy to be here with all of you. Thank you for coming. Stanley Nelson, thank you for creating such a remarkable and important document at such a critical time.
Thank you.
I'd like just to take a moment to ask you to give us perspective on why you decided to make this film at this time.
I think the simple reason would be that you know, my parents both went to HBCUs. My mother went to Talladega. My father went to Howard. He went to Howard and went on to Howard Dental School and became a dentist. And, you know, it changed his life. It changed my life. It changed my kids' life and their kids' life. And it'll keep changing, you know, all down through the generations. So that's, you know, one of the reasons. But I felt it was a story that had never been told, and I didn't know who else was going to tell it. It wasn't like people were waiting in line to tell this story. So I took it on.
One of the presenters talked about this notion, the brutality of ignorance. And it was really with a critical eye that you shared how challenging it was and how impactful the ramifications were of a group of people not having access to education and not having access to literacy. Talk about the economic impact that had on Black people in this country.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was really important for us to start the story in the time of enslavement, when it was illegal not only for African Americans to learn to read and write. I mean, this was by law that you couldn't learn to read and write. But, you know, I didn't even know until we started researching the film that it was illegal for white folks to teach Black people to read and write. And as somebody says, you know, in the film, you know, this is my slave. I can do whatever I want to this person. I can rape them. I can kill them. I can do whatever I want. But the one thing that I cannot do is I can't teach them to read and write, because it was illegal to teach Black people because education was so feared. And we really wanted to start the story there, because I think it's really important that we talk about, you know, how important education was seen, even during the time of enslavement.
Talk to us a little bit about how the institutions evolved over the course of the 20th century, and specifically some of the obstacles that were faced.
I would like to start, you know, in the 19th century, because I think one of the things that's happening that we're seeing now with so many schools is they're celebrating their 150th year. And that's because they started basically right after the Civil War, you know. So in 1865, the schools just took off. And for the next 25 or so years, you know, this is where, you know, schools were just started because it was felt, you know, by African Americans after the Civil War that all we have to do is get an education. Like, if we just can get this magic thing of an education, everything will be changed. And HBCUs were so important, you know, in that time and in that era.
Dr. Frederick, I'd love to hear your perspective. Where the film was going was to talk about the role that Howard played in terms of setting the stage for integration. And the view was that no other organization beyond a Black organization could have been able to drive the sort of change that was initiated by Howard. Talk a little bit about the history of that.
Yeah, sure. You know, I think there are two things to keep in mind. One is the way the university was founded, I think, gives Howard that chalice, as it were, to be the fulcrum of that type of a movement. General Howard and 16 other congressional church members got together to come up with the idea of forming Howard. The 17th president of this country, Andrew Johnson, signed a charter on March 2nd, 1867 to start Howard University. The irony of that is that he was a known racist, and on the same day that he signed the charter to start Howard University, he also vetoed the first Reconstruction Acts. One of the lessons, I think, in that is the fact that here's a white general who lost his arm in the war, decides that the education of Blacks is that critical, that he still goes to this president who obviously is not necessarily in favor of seeing Black people rise, you know, as the film suggests, and yet still he needs him to sign that type of a charter to start the institution. You come into the 1920s and the Board of Trustees at Howard University decides to appoint an African-American to lead Howard University. That begins across the country, a look at, can we really do this? That gives Howard that impetus, that gives Howard that push, as it were, to say, not only are these institutions for Black people, but they can be run by Black people. Because up until then, as was pointed out in the film, in several places, white men were running these institutions. And most people don't realize I'm only the seventh Black to lead Howard University. Mm-hmm. I'm the 17th president. There have been 10 white men who've been president of Howard University. There have been more white men who've been president than Black men, and they were therefore running them in a certain manner that was not necessarily in an open fashion to really allow that growth. And as a result of that push, you're absolutely right. 34 years later, all of the schools were accredited. All of them were led by Black deans. And that began a different type of a push. If you look at the physicians in this country, Black physicians, Howard University is still responsible for the most Black physicians in this country. You look at dentists, you go to many a field, and that's where I think that impetus comes from. So that liberation of, as it were, of thought, that liberation to dream, and I would say that liberation to execute on the broader social construct that we were going to populate the country with educated Black people, both men and women, because I think the other untold story about HBCUs is that HBCUs were also really at the forefront of having women and men as co-ed institutions, and having them lead. The first chemistry chair in this country was a woman. The first lawyer, female lawyer, who graduated and passed the bar in D.C. was a Howard grad. So Howard was again at the forefront, and that was in the 1800s.
So from that origin to the 80s or 90s, when you got your first degree from Howard as an undergrad, to today, how do you think about the difference in terms of the role that Howard needs to play today?
The role that Howard University needs to play is one of excellence. Because yes, the dynamic is different. There's opportunity for Black students to go everywhere, to dream the biggest dream they could have. The dream that I had when I came to this country as a 16-year-old with sickle cell anemia and wanted to become a physician. Howard University is the only place in the world that I could fulfill that dream. No one at Howard ever questioned my capacity or ability. And that's the difference, I think, with why you have an HBCU. It's more critical today, and let me tell you why. Last year, less Black men in this country applied to medical school than in 1976. 40 years, just think of the 40-year gap and what has happened in this country over those 40 years, and yet still, less Black men applied to medical school last year than they did in 1976. We have a crisis. We have a crisis that's taking place right in front of us, but the focus is often that there's opportunity everywhere. That opportunity isn't quite what I think it's made out to be. Mm-hmm. That opportunity, I call it a sheltered opportunity. It's an opportunity with a lot of things attached to it. And the thing that HBCUs do is that HBCUs take away those shackles from the opportunity. It's an unbridled opportunity when you go to an HBCU to fulfill not just your potential, but like me, wanting to become an internist, could attend a university like Howard with sickle cell and become a surgeon, work 110 hours a week as a resident, and not have anyone question my capacity to do that, but rather have people give me the encouragement and support to do it. And that's what our HBCUs have to do today.
Thank you, and I think that that's so accurate in terms of the broader HBCU community. Obviously, the Thurgood Marshall College Fund plays an integral role in creating that community. Can you just talk a little bit about the origin of the institution and the role that it plays today?
There are really two organizations in the HBCU space. We call them HBCU advocacy groups. One is the United Negro College Fund, and one is the Thurgood Marshall College Fund. The distinction is generally that we represent the public HBCUs, or state institutions, or what we call publicly supported institutions. We represent some 47 HBCUs in the country. By the way, there are 101 HBCUs. 12 of them are community colleges, junior colleges. 89 of them are four-year schools. We have 47 of those 89 institutions, representing about 80% of all HBCU students. We just celebrated our 30th anniversary this year, and we're proud, you know, to be strong advocates for the HBCU space. And another tidbit that most don't realize is right now in this very polarized world, politically speaking, more than half of HBCUs sit in Republican states because we're in the South. We're the Georgia, Mississippi, Alabama, New Orleans. That's where we're located. And so the idea that we can do this work without reaching out to everyone, we're challenging, because you've got to. The work that we have is figuring out how to navigate in an environment where, frankly, you know, a lot of the folks there don't share the same political views as we do.
Let's talk a little bit more about the conversation that's happening across the country around race and identity. And in one aspect, there's a tremendous need and desire for togetherness. At the other end of the spectrum is a need and desire for independent identity and pride. How do you reconcile those two things? I'd be interested in all of your perspectives.
I consider President Obama not just a friend, but a mentor. And one of the reasons is because I think in a lot of ways we share a bit of a historical past that binds us. When I convinced him to come and give the commencement address at Howard, he told me, "I'm going to address our issue." And that issue, which he addressed at our commencement, was, "You've got to allow everybody to own their own blackness." And I think that's a speech that in the next 5 to 10 years, people are going to go back and look at carefully and realize just how profound a statement he was making. He was born of a Kenyan father and a white mother. People who look like him still delegitimize his blackness. And we then associate that with policy decisions, and we go on and on. I'm from the Caribbean. People on my campus delegitimize my blackness, because they feel that if I have to engage around a $221 million federal appropriation, that is because I don't represent their point of view. And that actually, I totally disagree with. Our civil rights leaders always were at the table. You don't have to eat what's at the table. You could push it back, but you at least need to know what's on the table. Yeah. And that's one of the things I think right now I am concerned about. Are we isolating ourselves, or are we engaging? There are people who are ignorant about who we are, why we should exist, why we should excel. We make a lot of assumptions about decisions that people make. Howard's federal appropriation has increased more rapidly under Republican presidents than it has under Democratic presidents. That's number one. Number two, President Obama's first budget that he recommended was a 10% cut in Howard's federal appropriation. That doesn't mean he doesn't like Howard. That doesn't mean that he doesn't like HBCUs. But the reality is that there are lots of other things that go into play, and we have to be at the table. Speaker Ryan was the person who restored Howard's 10% in the final markup of that bill. I don't share 90-something percent of his views.
But you do that.
But the 1% of his views when it comes to raising Howard's appropriation, I'm there. And I'm going to be there making my argument. And so the last thing I'd say about this, especially for the young people that are here today, is that just as the way Howard started, if General Howard decided he was not going to sit in a room with President Johnson because he was a racist and not get him to sign the charter for Howard, Howard doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. And so we cannot isolate ourselves. We have to be at the table, agitating, pushing. My role is to take away all the barriers so that my students could protest, including protest against me. But let's protest in earnest, and let's be clear who the enemy is and not get confused about where we're putting our protests and what we're agitating for. Not romanticize about the activism, but be purposeful about our activism.
Yeah, I just wanted to add, I think that for us looking, you know, on the outside in, you know, a lot of the HBCU presidents and administrators are kind of caught between a rock and a hard place. You know, they need the money to survive, but on the outside, we're saying, you know, well, why are you going to talk to Trump?
I'd also say that, you know, and this is maybe controversial to some, but we are multifaceted human beings. You're not just black. You have so many other characteristics that describe who you are. And so the idea that you somehow lose your street cred or your blackness because you also are other things is a problem. I think it's but and. Mm-hmm. I think you can include others in your world and better understand. We're no longer, see, you all are fortunate. Yeah, when I grew up in South Florida, there was black and white. I mean, that's just kind of what it was. And now there's brown and there's yellow and there's mixed and there's biracial and there's all of this stuff. And so one of the things that we strongly encourage our students to do at HBCUs is to also realize that diversity is a two-way street. You know, inclusion is a two-way street. You too have some obligation to open yourself up and learn and be willing to understand that there's a world out there that is not purely the world that you grew up in. And that's an opportunity. It's not an indictment of your world. You should be very proud of who you are.
We've come to the end. I want to thank you for such an important film.
Thank you.
Thank you all for the legacy that you're creating.